Okay, so there are several functions to water, and you can read them right here so you can see why water is so important and why we can't go without it. So it's going to help keep those cells, their shape, their rigidity. It definitely helps with regulate body temperature, helps you cool the body. So because water conducts heat, so especially during exercise, cool water is going to be a good idea. It's going to act as a lubricant. It's going to cushion your body tissue. It's going to help transport nutrients and waste products. It's going to be act as a solvent, so which means it's a liquid in which solute can be dissolved to create a solution. Helps with chemical reactions. It helps split, your macronutrients. Also, is going to provide some trace minerals like zinc, copper, fluoride can be found in water. And oh yeah, I hit the last one already. Perfect. All right. So electrolytes. So electrolytes are minerals that carry an electrical charge when dissolved in water. There are three of them. As we already saw before, the primary extracellular, which means outside of the cell, is going to be your sodium, your chloride. And the primary intracellular inside there is going to be the potassium. And so the cells can control their movement of electrolytes. And so therefore control where water goes, because water is going to follow those electrolytes, or it's going to specifically follow sodium. So if I move more sodium into the cell, then I'm going to get more water into the cell by passive diffusion or osmosis, excuse me. And so I do need to transport proteins in order to move those electrolytes in and out of the cell membranes. And as your water in your body decreases, sodium and the solute levels in the blood are therefore going to increase. Your body does need to excrete at least 500 milliliters of water a day, regardless of your intake, to clear your body's waste products. All right, so let's talk about some nursing diagnoses. So one that would fit here with water consumption would be fluid volume deficits. So we could say, fluid volume deficit related to, which would be the etiology, and then as evidenced by. And so as evidence would be the signs and symptoms here. So as evidenced by orthostatic hypotension, of a blood pressure drop of, a systolic drop of 40 points from sitting to standing, very severe orthostatic hypotension we'd be seeing there. So what we see is with fluid volume deficit, that's the nursing diagnosis. The medical diagnosis would be, you're very correct, it would be dehydration. So this could be either related to excess fluid output, so like I'm urinating too much fluid, or I have difficulty taking in additional fluids. It's one of those two. It's got to be an in or an out. Older adults and infants are most at risk. Why do you think so? Well, they have a decreased fluid reserve. You can see here all the signs and symptoms I went through already. Big thing is treatment is going to be replaced with fluids. Usually it's going to need to be done intravenously if it's severe enough for you or me to seeing it. Now at home we might have some fluid volume deficit after vomiting or diarrhea. We would want to increase our fluid intake to prevent it from becoming a medical emergency, which would be a fluid loss. So you would see like if you lost 10% or more of your body weight in one day, that's going to be fluids. That's not going to be anything else. Right, and then the exact opposite nursing diagnosis then is going to be fluid volume excess. So this is where we see that you're retaining fluids. And so this can be seen specifically as edema. Like here's some nice pitting edema specifically. And so that's where the extra fluid in the interstitial spaces is seeping into the cells and causing this. So a high sodium intake can cause that. So can kwashiorkor. Remember we talked about that earlier. So for some people, this can actually end up causing hypertension. So we might need to use the treatment would be to either reduce sodium consumption, increase the protein intake. Again, we need to know what the etiology of the cause is. So is it excess fluid volume related to a high sodium intake, as evidenced by patient states they consume 8 milligrams, or excuse me, 8 grams a day of sodium, or as evidenced by patient states they eat fast food for every meal. Those would all be appropriate nursing diagnoses. So here we're going to see, you're going to again see that increased fluid retention, more than 10% more than normal. So now my weight has gone up. Then we also have this thing called water intoxication. You might have heard of this with athletes. So what happens is if you consume a large amount of water in a short time, you can actually end up diluting your electrolytes too much and cause muscle cramps, a decreased blood pressure, and weakness. But it has to be, again, a consumption of large volume of water in a short time. This can also occur with dehydration if you treat dehydration with just water and not electrolytes. But again, it has to be, it's more of a severe case. It's not just, you had one case of diarrhea and now drinking some fluid is going to cause, you don't need to go out and get the Gatorade right away or the Pedialyte, for example. This slide right here just gives you a whole bunch of tips for hydration. These could be great tips you can use for your patient who has fluid volume deficit, and you might see this for use in your practice. Right, on to minerals. All right, so minerals, are going to be inorganic. Here it gives you a whole bunch of overview of functions of minerals. They have lots and lots of things. Let's talk about them specifically. All right, so here's the definition of minerals. Not going to read it to you. There are 16 essential minerals, which again means you must consume them through your diet. We did, classify, we classify everything so far, so we're going to also classify our minerals. We say that they're either going to be major or they're going to be minor. So for them to be major, that means they have to be needed in more than 100, or excuse me, 100 or more milligrams a day. So the only thing that differentiates between major and trace is going to be how much you need of them. So it does not make them more important because it could. I would love to hear if somebody could make an argument saying that iron is going to be less important, even though it's a trace, than sulfur, for example. Then you can see for trace, what makes them trace is that generally you need 20 milligrams or less of them in a day. Mineral toxicity is going to be more of an issue with these trace. That occurs when those trace elements are taken in megadoses. We're going to worry about bioavailability again some more. You need to have both major and trace minerals for good health. Sources are mainly going to be plants and some animals. Americans tend to be at risk for iron, calcium, and zinc deficiencies. You might have seen that in yourself when you did your super tracker. All right, so bioavailability. So here's this nice picture that shows lots of things that can change bioavailability. Again, it's the rate and extent of absorption. So things that affect it are going to be these different, like phthalate, polyphenols, oxalate, the acidity of the intestinal environment, your need, your fiber. We're going to go into those in specific examples. All right, so calcium. So first of all, calcium is, let me just see here, something's going on. Give me a second. Oh, what happened here? So we'll pull this open just a little bit, just make sure you can see those. Well, all right. Well, I guess I can't get it to work correctly. So we'll do it like this the best we can, but you have it on your slide. So sorry about that. So calcium is the most abundant mineral in your body. You have more calcium than anything else. Now, most of that calcium is going to be found in your bones. Actually, 99% of your calcium is in your bones. So, I mean, think you a lot of your body mass is going to be bone, so a lot of calcium. You can see there what the functions are of calcium. The adequate intake is going to be based on your age, your gender, and your physiological need. And then food sources is very important. You probably think of milk and dairy products, but also these green leafy vegetables. So if I'm a vegan, you're going to definitely need to tell me about these things like broccoli, legumes, small fish, especially if you end up eating the bones, like sardines. Another one is going to be yogurt. Yogurt is going to be a really good source. So it's best to consume calcium. Things that are not good sources would be things like butter, cream cheese. Those are predominantly fat. And cottage cheese is not a good source of calcium because it's actually going to be lost in the processing. Very important that you know these and how the things that are going to aid in absorption or hinder absorption. So these are things that are going to make it that are going to affect the bioavailability. So things like having lactose in milk actually makes it easier for your body to absorb calcium. Having enough vitamin D, that's one of its main roles, is to help with the absorption of calcium. Having this with a whole meal is going to help aid in the absorption, and also exercising. And as I said before, age changes. So as you're a child, the bioavailability when you're a child is actually greater, so you'll absorb about 75% of the calcium that you consume. Things like that can hinder absorption now is like this oxalic acid in tea, for example, and tannins. Those are binders. It's going to bind to the calcium, and then your body's not able to absorb it. Some leafy vegetables are also going to do that, as well as high fiber or laxatives. Those are all going to be things that are going to hinder absorption. Now, one thing I forgot to mention, if you might be curious, why would a whole meal help aid your absorption? Well, it's because it's going to be more soluble because you're creating a more acidic environment when you're eating food. So you're going to secrete more hydrochloric acid. All right, then a couple other things that are going to hinder your absorption. Some medications like anticonvulsants and aluminum-containing antacids. Having a sedentary lifestyle, you're not going to have as many calcium deposits in your bones. Excessive intake of alcohol is going to reduce your bone density. Smoking and caffeine are also going to hinder your absorption of calcium. Right, so we might, be seeing supplements. So we need to, number one, know that compliance is necessary. This is not a sometimes medication. We need to consistently take it. Other things to know is that the medication is always going to be combined with another substance to make the tablet. So the two main ones are going to be calcium carbonate, which is going to have the most calcium in it. But in each tablet, there's going to be about 500 to 600 milligrams of that calcium. And then we also have calcium citrate or calcium lactate, and each pill is going to have about 200 milligrams of calcium. Now, your body can only absorb about 500, maybe 600 milligrams of calcium at a time. So, taking two calcium carbonates is not going to be any more effective because half of that is just going to go through without being absorbed. But now, with the calcium citrate or lactate, we do want to take two of those tablets at a time, maybe two and a half or three. Then you can see what right on your slide it does have what deficiency would look like or toxicity. The upper limit for calcium is 2,500 milligrams. You don't need to know that, but I just want to put that in perspective when the normal intake for a female our age would be 1,000 milligrams. Another thing that can cause factors that could cause deficiency is race. It's more common in white and Asian descent. Gender, females, having a family history. And also transplant patients. So this is going to come back again when we talk about transplant patients. Toxicity, other things that can actually cause constipation, urinary stone formation, and reduce the absorption of iron and zinc when you're taking in excessive amounts of calcium. Most people do not consume enough calcium though, so that would have to really be normally with supplements we would see that. All right, phosphorus. Not even really going to talk about it too much. It will come up again when we talk about renal patients. But you can see here, more what the functions are. Food source is going to be dairy, animal. A lot of the same food sources of calcium are going to be found with phosphorus. Then we have here some other major minerals would be like magnesium. Only reason I bring up magnesium really is because it can also help with muscle function because it helps. You can see here it regulates nerve and muscle function. So specifically with heart muscles, so people might be on a magnesium supplement to also help with their blood pressure. And long-term diuretic use does put you at greater risk for deficiency because as water goes, so does magnesium. Sulfur, not even to really talk about it. Sodium, very important to talk about because of its effects on blood pressure vo and volume. It is an electrolyte. Now the CDC actually recommends that for Americans, all Americans who are 40 years of age or older, African Americans, or if you have hypertension, to be on a diet that is low in sodium, which means 1,500 milligrams or less in a day. When you actually look at the American populations, 2/3 of all Americans fall into one of these three categories.